Very good day to you. I trust that your new year started well and that you experience the presence and the peace of our Lord. Come, let us pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we worship you. We come to you in the name of our Lord Jesus. We declare that you are our King, and that we would like to trust you, that we pray that you would bless us in this year. We look forward to what you have installed for us. Please come and speak to us as we open your word. We would like to hear and receive a word of encouragement and inspiration, wisdom from you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. We have recently, in entering this new year, started to look at the theme of standing firm and conquering. We have seen that we are living among many challenges surrounding us, like the COVID pandemic, some political unrest, corruption, and evil. We saw that God announced conflict between the seed of the serpent and mankind way back there in Genesis 3. And last time we suggested that we might take all earthly battles back to these roots. We saw how Jesus conquered on the cross. We also looked at one of the ways that we as church may work with our Lord against the kingdom of darkness. And that was the spreading the word of God to all the nations and stand firm in our battle. That was our previous message, which was called Being God's White Horse. Today, we would look at how Daniel participated in the same battle. We will also see how he conquered by being faithful, fearful, and through praying. Our main scripture comes from Daniel chapter 10. Please also note, as we read this, the parts printed in bold and in blue on the screen is to highlight the frailty and fear. We are looking today at vulnerability, faithfulness, and fearfulness that we may have in our spiritual battle to stand firm and to conquer. We also find these traits in Daniel, who was mightily used by God, and he was told that he was also greatly beloved by God. We read Daniel chapter 10, verse 1 to 21. In the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a message was revealed to Daniel, whose name was called Belteshazzar. The message was true, but the appointed time was long, and he understood the message and had understanding of the vision. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. I ate no pleasant food, no meat or wine came into my mouth, nor did I anoint myself at all, till 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. Now on the 24th day of the first month, as I was by the side of the great river, that is the Tigris, I lifted my eyes and looked, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen, whose waist was girded with gold of Uphaz. His body was like beryl, his face like the appearance of lightning, his eyes like torches of fire, his arms and feet like burnished bronze in color, and the sound of his words like the voice of a multitude. And I, Daniel, alone saw the vision, for the men who were with me did not see the vision, but a great terror fell upon them, so that they fled to hide themselves. Therefore I was left alone when I saw this great vision, and no strength remained in me, for my vigor was turned to frailty in me, and I retained no strength. Yet I heard the sounds of his words, and while I heard the sound of his words, I was in a deep sleep on my face, with my face to the ground. Suddenly, a hand touched me, which made me tremble on my knees and on the palms of my hands. And he said to me, O Daniel, man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak to you and stand upright, for I have now been sent to you. While I was speaking this word to me, I stood trembling. Then he said to me, Do not fear, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard, and I have come because of your words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days, and behold, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I had been left alone there with the kings of Persia. Now these are indication of spiritual forces in the heavenlies. Verse 14. Now I have come to make you understand that what will happen to your people in the latter days. For the vision refers to many days yet to come. When he had spoken such words to me, I turned my face toward the ground and became speechless. And suddenly, one having the likeness of the sons of men touched my lips. Then I opened my mouth and spoke, saying to him who stood before me, My Lord, because of the vision, my sorrows have overwhelmed me and have retained no strength. For how can this servant of my Lord talk with you, my Lord? As for me, no strength remains in me now, nor is any breath left in me. Then again, the one having the likeness of a man touched me and strengthened me, and he said, O man, greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be to you. Be strong. So when he spoke to me, I was strengthened and said, Let my Lord speak, for you have strengthened me. Then he said, Do you know why I have come to you? And now I must return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I have gone forth, indeed the prince of Greece will come. But I will tell you what is noted in the scripture of truth. No one upholds me against these, except Michael, your prince. We read how Daniel was mourning 3 full weeks. And he also fasted by not eating pleasant food. He also didn't groom himself during that time. That is, didn't care well, look well after himself. Why did he do that? We know that he had done it before when we read in chapter 9. But that was about 3 years before this. And then he had read Jeremiah, who prophesied that Israel would return to Jerusalem after having been 70 years in exile in Babylon. Daniel was taken with the first group that went to exile into Babylon. He realized that in the first year of King Cyrus of Persia, that about 70 years had elapsed. Therefore, it must now be the time that God's people may return home to Jerusalem. And Daniel was about 18 years old when he was taken to Babylon. Now, in the first year of King Cyrus, he then must be about 88 years old. But he's still continuing in service. And this is quite remarkable indeed. But he also served God as king. And then he prayed for this prophecy of Jeremiah to be fulfilled. And that God granted that King Cyrus allowed the Jews to return. In spite of the fact that it was a prophecy that God declared through Jeremiah, Daniel didn't take it for granted that it automatically would be fulfilled. He still felt the urge to very sincerely intercede for it to happen and devoted himself in prayer for this. What is interesting is that when the people of God returned, Daniel decided to remain in Persia. This is very interesting. Normally the Jews that would not return to Jerusalem might have adopted well in the lifestyle where they now lived, and they might not have been part of the faithful remnant of Israel. In our scripture of today, It's already in the third year of King Cyrus. Yet Daniel is still faithfully serving, even though he seemingly was supposed to remain in office only until the first year of King Cyrus. He must have been convinced that he had a calling to serve God in a different way, because he hadn't retired yet, nor had he returned home to Jerusalem to help God's people rebuild their city and the temple. As indication of his faithfulness, we may find in Daniel 6, verse 20, where the Persian king spoke to him after he was thrown into the lion's den. Remember, the king was trapped into making a decree. Now, Daniel 6, verse 20 then reads as follows. The king spoke, saying to Daniel, Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you from the lions? Have you heard? Your God, whom you serve continually. What a testimony this is. If we read through the book, we'll see Daniel's faithfulness. We'll especially note that Daniel is very faithful in listening to the word of God, and also extremely faithful in seeking God's face to do his will. He was living in a relationship with God, listening to God and doing what God wants. His faithfulness may remind us of what the prophet Isaiah says in Isaiah chapter 66. Let's read verse 1, 2, and 5. Thus says the Lord, but on this one will I look, on him who is poor and of contrite spirit, and who trembles at my word. Hear the word of the Lord, you who tremble at his word. Wow, this is deep respect and a fear for God. God is holy, he is the creator, he is God Almighty. And this indicates someone who has an upright character, who is described as having a poor and contrite spirit, and respect the word of God with fear and trembling. Now, Daniel was serving after all these years, now more than 70 years in office. But there was another disaster that caused Daniel to now again to seek God in prayer and to intercede. What could that be? We have read in verse 1 that it was the third year of King Cyrus now. It would be wise to investigate what was happening in Daniel's life, maybe also find out about what was happening in the lives of the Israelites who were now returning to Jerusalem. The destruction of Jerusalem in 586 and of the temple and the Babylonian exile were huge disasters in the lives of God's people. Just how they felt about this disaster, we may read what is written in the Psalms about it. Psalm 137, verse 1 to 4. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yah, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hung our harps upon the willows in the midst of it. For there those who carried us away captive asked of us a song, and those who plundered us requested mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion, of Jerusalem. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? They were devastated. But the remnant see God's face diligently and cried out to him. Daniel was one of them. And like we have said, Daniel prayed in chapter 9 for their return to fulfill Jeremiah's prophecy. Now, there must now be a new crisis to be resolved. Let's look in the history and turn to the book of Ezra and read from verse 1 to 3. Ezra 1 verse 1 to 3. Now, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, so that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom, and also put it in writing, saying, Thus says Cyrus, king of Persia, All the kingdoms of the earth the Lord God of heaven has given me, and he has commanded me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Who is among you of all his people? May his God be with him, and let him go up to Jerusalem, which is in Judah, and build the house of the Lord God of Israel. He is God, which is in Jerusalem. It's amazing how a pagan king can announce such a decree that benefited God's people. Here we see what happened then in this first year of King Cyrus. That was the decree that the Jews now may return to Jerusalem, an answer of the prayer of Daniel in chapter 9, after he had read Jeremiah 25, verse 11 to 12. If we now turn to Ezra 3, verse 8, we continue with the history and we read that the Israelites are now between 1 and 2 years back in Jerusalem. Verse 8, now in the second month of the second year of their coming to the house of God at Jerusalem. So this is about the time of Daniel's prayer of chapter 10 that we have read. Then we read after this, Ezra 4 verse 1 to 5. Now when the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard that the descendants of the captivity were building the temple of the Lord God of Israel. Verse 4, then the people of the land tried to discourage the people of Judah. They troubled them in building and hired counselors against them to frustrate their purpose all the days of Cyrus, king of Persia. And this is bad news. God's people experience opposition and interference when they wanted to rebuild the ruins of the city and temple. Could it be that this news reached Daniel? And in Daniel's faithfulness and commitment, he realized that he needed to pray and to fast again to get an answer from the Lord, because he was so faithful and living in a sincere relationship with God, he could actually pray with a pure heart. And this is the position from which Daniel could pray with a clear conscience, as we read in Psalm 24, verse 3 and 5. Who may ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, he shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. We also need to pray to God in this way. Let the life of Daniel be a testimony to us. His faithfulness and living faith relationship to God led to his being used by God in the lives of God's people. He could do work on his knees, work that was needed to allow God to intervene in the battle in the spiritual realm. But Daniel was also fearful out of deep respect. His faithfulness and fearfulness work together. Let us look at some examples in the Bible where this humble attitude can also be seen. This is opposed to arrogance or haughtiness that we are warned against in various places in the Bible. For example, in James 4 verse 6, which says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. A person with such frail and fearful attitude is Gideon. We read about Gideon in Judges 6, verse 12, 15, and 16. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, The Lord is with you, you mighty man of valor. So he said to him, O my Lord, how can I save Israel? Indeed, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house. And the Lord said to him, Surely I will be with you. We may also read about Jeremiah, who when he was called by the Lord, he felt that he was too young and he wouldn't be able to speak. But God touched his mouth and sent him to speak with a promise that he will deliver him. We may also recall Moses at the burning bush when God sent him to the Pharaoh to deliver God's people. Moses also felt frail and he had fear. He told God, Who am I? He said that he was slow of speech and tongue and he felt unworthy. But God sent him anyway and promised Moses that he will be with him. Even Jesus, as a man, as a human on earth, experienced this frailty. Let's read Matthew 26, verse 36 to 39. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane and said to the disciples, Sit here while I go and pray over there. And he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. Then he said to them, My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. He went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. It should encourage us that even Jesus as human went through the same emotions and that he was frail and dependent upon our Heavenly Father. It is also what Jesus is describing in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5, when he speaks about the poor in spirit who are blessed, those who mourn who will be comforted, the meek who shall inherit the earth, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled, the merciful who shall obtain mercy, the pure in heart, the peacemakers, and those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, whom all receive promises of blessings. Also, to Daniel, the godly messenger tells him not to fear. Let's read carefully again what Daniel was told in verse 12. Daniel 10 verse 12. Then he said to me, Do not fear, Daniel. From the first day that you set your heart to understand and to humble yourself before God. Your words were heard, and I have come because of your words. Thus we may say that Daniel's humble heart, his deep respect, his faithfulness and commitment brought God into action in the spiritual battle. What was happening in the realm of this world with havoc and opposition of people were resolved in the heavenlies, and God intervened to bring about outcome on earth. Yes, when we get discouraged because of coronaviruses, lockdowns and corruption, other challenges, we may, as faithful servants of God, humbly and dependently go to our Heavenly Father in sincere intercession and prayer and cry out to Him for outcome, and He will hear and answer us. What an amazing privilege do we have. We need to go wholeheartedly and in dependence like Daniel. But we also find these same ways with Paul. Let's read about Paul's frailty and his fearfulness in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 1 to 5. And I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I was with you in weakness, in fear, and in much trembling, and my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Do you sense how meek and humble Paul was? Yet he was so powerfully used by God. As the saying goes, meekness is not weakness. God wants to pour His power through us. We need to acknowledge our frailty and God's power and the victory that Jesus achieved on our behalf over the enemy. Paul also speaks about our frail bodies in his second letter to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 7 to 10. And he says, "But we have this treasure in earthen vessels," that is clay pots, "that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body." We are vulnerable and breakable like clay pots, seemingly broken in many ways. Yet we are not forsaken by God. Yet we are not destroyed. There is hope for us in this battle. Paul says the life of Jesus will be manifested in our body, in our humble acknowledgement of who we are. Shall we also allow God to fulfill His purposes in our lives? Let us not get discouraged in circumstances that sometimes seem against us or God's cause which we try to accomplish. Let us persevere in joy, knowing that Jesus is our Lord, and it pleases Him that we are faithful and fearful. Also, we may know that when we might feel not skilled enough, when God calls us for a task, He would strengthen us and use us. We need to trust Him and expect that from Him. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You that we may look up unto You. Even though we might be frail, we might be fearful and tremble in front of Your throne. Thank You that You are looking for us to have such a meek and gentle spirit and a contrite heart, and that You will reward us, that even though we are clay pots that may easily be broken, that it will release Your strong power and might through us. Thank You that we may ask You to be with us, to equip us and to use us in this year, and allow us to stand firm and to conquer with You. In Jesus' name, Amen. Receive the blessing of our Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace.
Give us one more moment, one more day, just one more year. We're